Hello everyone, hello Hyderabad. I live in Bangalore, so it's always good to come here. And I know I'm between you and the great, nice evening that you can have with your family, so I'll try to have a very short and crisp value for your time. And so the topic is hacking your way to the top, essential skills for product leaders. You heard Arun talk about, we discussed the science of product management, we discussed about the art of product management. This will go to yet another level where I think it will be a personal discovery. And what I'm going to talk about is really how can you as an individual, without worrying about whether your organization supports it, whether your manager supports it, how can you set yourself loose on the path of self-discovery and really become if that's what you want to be, right? So I think that's what will be the context here. Now, one question I have to all of you is one word that's very important here is hacking your way to the top, right? So what is that top really? And what I want you guys to all help me with is just take a moment of self-reflection and think what is the top that you want to accomplish. Everyone has a different top. Everyone has a different notion of what they really want to be. And so I want really to take a minute, think about yourself, don't talk to each other, because everything is what you do is really important. And for some of you, if you would like to share what is your notion of a top, we'll pass on the mic to you so that you can share about it. So just take a minute, think about it, and we'll come back to that, right? Perfectly all right, yeah. I mean, if you, any of you already have an idea about what your top is, go ahead and share, raise your hand and share that. And there's nothing wrong in that because that's a deeply personal thing. The key thing is not to worry about what your top is. The key thing is to worry about the fact that do you have a top at all? Do you know what's your goal? Do you know what you really want to do? Do you know what you really want to be? Do you really know what you stand for? Or you are just you're just like a log of wood that's flowing in the river, and wherever the river takes you, there's a beautiful concept by Edward de Bono. He calls it the water logic and the rock logic. The water logic is basically where the water doesn't worry about, the rock worries about maintaining itself, but the water doesn't worry about it. The water doesn't really have any ego. So wherever it finds a rock, it knows it cannot fight the rock. Right now, over a millions of years, it will definitely fight the rock and get scare the hell out of the rock. But then right now, it just goes around it, right? So the thing is, everyone has a different top, different goal. And I want you to just think of that, because that's an important thing, because I don't care whether you remember anything from this session or not. What I do care for is, at the end of the day, when you hit the bed tonight, do you know that you have a top? Do you know why you are here in this industry? Do you know why you are living, for that matter? Do you know why you have been sent to this earth? 7 billion people of us, we are all living meaningless lives here. What is your meaning? I'm more interested in that. So is anyone willing to share that? We all promised to each other that this is something that we respect for each other. So no judgment, no anything like that. Yeah, please. Okay. Okay. Great, wonderful. All right, okay. Thank you. Times person of year, obviously. I think that's a great, so, in the industry, the good thing is, whatever you do, you will become a headline, right? What you do want to become headline for all the right reasons. So that's important part of it, right? Yeah, so great.
Want to become a CEO for a small company, show employability.
Wonderful. Anyone else? Okay.
So that's either giving back knowledge or giving back to the community.
Yeah. Yeah. So I agree. I think a lot of our friends who talked about a career-based top that they want to accomplish, that's a great perspective. I admire what you said. My personal favorite would be something in that direction. Have you heard of the name of Muhammad Yunus? Anyone knows who is Muhammad Yunus? Okay, not the bowler, not the Pakistan bowler. The Grameen Bank, Bangladesh, Nobel laureate, right? I love one of the things that he has said, actually. You know what he has said? He says, in next few years, we want to build a museum of poverty. and let that statement sink in your mind and in your conscience. He says, we want to build a museum of poverty because in the next 5 years or 7 years, we want to eradicate poverty from the face of earth. To the point that the future generations will have to go to a museum to know what poverty is. Can you find ever in your life a vision, a mission, something of top which is more compelling than that? Right? We are talking about an impact for 3 billion people which are poorest of the poor people. Right? And for a lot of people, that would be the kind of mission that they would leave everything and they say, we want to work with Muhammad Yunus. Right? That kind of a thing. So personal vision and aspiration is great. It's important. That's a step. I also want you to continue thinking about it and say, what is it that you really deeply care for at the end of the day? Right? A lot of us would at some point in time want to say, I need to go back and pay it back to the community. Give it back. Right? And let me be very honest. We Indians are totally lousy in that. We don't really believe in paying it back. So one of the things that I think we should do and start really practicing is more of paying it back kind of a thing. Because each one of us is unique. Each one of us is different. If you cannot be unique and different, forget about product leader. You are dealing with bigger problems in life first. Fix them and then we'll talk about what is a product leader. Is that okay? Right? So let's talk about some of the things and keep your vision in mind. Keep refining it. Sorry. Yes. Great. Yeah, thank you. Okay, so let's keep going here. So what is a product manager? Let's come back to this room now and talk a little more about it. Which one of the product managers you look like? What my friends think I do? It's like the mailman kind of a thing, right? I mean, all it's doing is just taking requirements from them from one room and putting them in the other room, right? Or mom thinks, say, you are this cool Steve Jobs dude, right? You make these sexy iPhones and that's what half the world is caring for and all that kind of stuff there. And of course, some of you have watched this movie, Office Space, right? I think the best movie that you have to watch 100 times in your career, right? This is what our industry is all about, right? Yeah, playing with the red stapler, that guy, right? What my colleagues think I do, right? This is like, what are you doing to, and this of course, what I think I do, we all think we are Superman. We are saving the world, right? We are saving the world from these monster aliens that are coming and the Martians are coming and we have to do something there, right? That kind of stuff. And what I actually do? Running like headless chicken. I have no clue. I'm just running helter-skelter because there are like, I'm serving like 200 managers, that kind of a thing. How many of you serve more than one managers? Long back in my career, somebody told me, the day you know that you are serving more than one person, you are a manager. Right? Because only engineers are entitled to serve one person. So if in your mind you have a confusion whether I'm an engineer, forget about titles. I hate titles. I think titles should be thrown away. Only then we can build a great human society, whether it's at work, whether it's in society, whether it's in profession or a company, right? So forget about titles. Look at how many people you are serving, right? If you're serving only one master, then yes, you are fit to be inside the cubicle. But if you're serving more, then you are obviously destined for more complex things. More complex means bigger things in some sense, right? So with that little bit of a humor, let's look at some of the dark humor as well. Some of the grim part of the product management community. And this is from 280 Group, which is one of the groups I respect for the research that they do. And they, you know how many execs didn't understand product management? PM here is product management, not the project management. Any guess globally, how many percentage of execs who don't understand product management? By the way, these include your managers. 60, 70, okay, let's see, global number 75. 75% of the execs don't have a clue what is product management. Right? So you are dealing with a lot of friction inside and up the thing because unless you can demonstrate the right value of your profession, of your role to your seniors, they are not very particularly going to be inclined to understand and show you the soft corner. And a lot of companies, how many do you think have no product management role or the role is not well defined? More than 75? Okay, let's look at the number. roughly about half the companies. And the last one, how many product managers do you think have undergone any kind of a training? 10. Anyone else? 1,000 would not be a percentage I'm looking at. 2? Okay, actually it's 2%. So that is the market that we are operating in, right? Now the reality is that only 2% of us have had some kind of a formal training, and I'm not by any stretch of imagination saying that formal training is the only route to competency. There were some very interesting questions. I think you asked the question. I'll have hopefully some answers for you as well. But the point I'm saying is that with these scary statistics, it's like you look at it, only 2% of us have got any training. And guess what? We are actually judging a lot of leaders and saying they don't understand it. I mean, how many of us, we understand this? Let's be a little more honest before we cast a stone at someone else and say, you don't understand it. I think it's time for us to be a little more honest about it, right? So let's look at some of the things that I have seen in the last 25 years of my career. And I have had a career with defense as a scientist and then with the industry. And I now consult a lot of large Fortune 100, Fortune 300 clients. So this is something that I have seen the last several years. I think if I see, I mean, 20 years back, it was very common that when I was at companies like Siemens and Philips, we were everyone. When I say we, it was the development team. We used to do product management. In those days, we used to call it more like a requirements manager or a requirements engineer. We were testers, we were developers, we were architects. And the scariest of them all, we were also the user designers. I mean, a computer science guy is telling, I think green will look better or purple will look better. I mean, like, I have no clue what will look better. I don't understand the color theory. How many of you in the room here have formally done any course on color theory? I see one hand going up. That is I see two now, actually, right? And the thing is, a lot of us do experiment with colors. We think like we are next to only Monet or we are next to only Michelangelo or somebody, right? I mean, that kind of a thing. So if I see at a very high level business, we were 20 years back, it was common to have relatively long business cycles, low competition, longevity protections. Today I see volatile business cycles, intense competition. It's very ephemeral and very open kind of a thing. Tech was largely stable. I mean, once you had, if you look at the technology adoption cycles have changed over the last few decades, right? I mean, for example, it took like 80 years for railroad to go to 75% of the penetration. Whereas it probably took only 20 days for Reliance Jio to reach that kind of a number, right? If you see by comparison. So the adoption cycles have crashed a lot and things really change much better. So it's mostly evolving tech. R&D those days used to be more large R&D, CapEx, IP. I mean, like I remember when I was at Philips, we had a Philips research lab. 2,000 people were doing research there. And unless you had like $500 million in a room, you could not think of starting a research kind of a thing there, right? And today, it's not really like that. Today, most of the web-based companies, all you need is a laptop and a free Wi-Fi and a coffee cup and you are on, that kind of a thing, right? People don't need $500 million to kind of start their business. Of course, a lot of business still require, and that's where the biggest challenge for them is, because the next disruption to those multi-billion dollar companies is not going to come from another multi-billion dollar companies. It is going to come from three hungry, extremely poverty-stricken guys who are across the street, who have no care about titles, who don't worry about taking a salary for 3 years, but they have a lot of fire in the belly. Enough to make a billion-dollar company shake with fever, right? I mean, these are the companies like WhatsApps of the world. These are the companies that two people will come up and say, I can start selling something on the net and will become a Flipkart. These are the two people companies who will say, I think I can become the biggest advertising network in the world and create an InMobi out of nowhere. These are not the companies that are looking for a confirmation bias. So please understand that your competition, if you work for $1 billion, John Chambers gave a beautiful statement. I think he was addressing CEOs of like Fortune 100 companies 6 months back, just before he announced the retirement. And one thing he said very remarkable, he says 40% of you will not exist in next 10 years. And these were like the biggest of the company CEOs. And here he was, John Chambers, talking about that. And I think he was being very, very nice and polite to them. You know, Standard & Poor's 500, S&P 500 index? S&P 500 index is actually the index of 500 of the biggest companies on this planet by market cap, which are listed either on New York Stock Exchange or NASDAQ. And guess what? Every 2 weeks, one company falls off that list. Every 2 weeks, one of the biggest of the 500 companies loses that spot to someone else. So when the biggest of the companies are not immune to that, what are we talking about, right? So mostly it has gone from a very frugal, from a CapEx to OpEx, open source and so on. Users, if you see, from a very relatively consistent, I mean, today I don't even know who's my user going to be, right? It's going to keep changing all the time. The markets, I mean, I remember I used to hear of this term. Has anyone heard of this term, MRD? Few people, the marketing requirements document. The last time I heard this term was 20 years back when I used to work at a $5 billion company that doesn't exist anymore. Anyone has heard of Siemens Telecom? I used to work for Siemens Telecom. It was a $20 billion company in 95, which doesn't exist. I mean, it got eaten up by Nokia and became Nokia Siemens and Nokia. On the other hand, I used to work for a $5 billion company in 2001, which is now a $60 billion company. Some of you have heard of them, Huawei. Yeah, I mean, those days we never used to make handsets. We used to actually make, I used to work routers on that. But the technology is changing. Today, how many routers does the world need? I mean, year on year, how much of routers and hard boxes are you going to put there? You'll have to find some other kind of business models, right? So things are changing in that sense. So the market windows are short. Where is the MRD? There's no MRD. Things are evolving. A lot of companies are realizing. There are companies like GE that have... So what comes to your mind if you think of a company like GE in terms of process and the way they do things? Come again? Cost strategy. Anything else? Any process framework kind of a thinking? Six Sigma, right? Guess what? Six Sigma is history. There is a beautiful talk on YouTube. You should watch it where GE is now proclaiming itself that they are the world's largest startup company. A 130-year-old company is saying that we are the world's largest startup now, right? Because that's the way they realize. They realize Six Sigma is useless. Six Sigma was the biggest joke played on software industry, next only to CMM. I'll come to that, right? The market windows, product windows, focus was mostly tech. Today, the most focus has moved from tech to product plus UX plus design. 5 years back, I had a friend who used to work on a software stack at Nokia. This was like 5-6 years back. He said, today there are websites in China where you can go there, you can log in. Like, I think there are some people here from Dell, for example, right? I met some of them at the lunchtime. And Dell has been a pioneer in really design, like customize your own laptop kind of a thing there. So you can go online, and that's how people have ordered Dell. There were websites 5 years back in China where you could have been any company with a little bit of a capital, and you say, I want to launch my own cell phone, and you go there and you say, how much of screen size I want? Do I want a numeric keypad? Do I want a touch screen? Do I want a charger? Do I want this? Do I want that? You can make your bill of material and you can launch it. You can call it Lava, you can call it Intex, you can call it anything. So what are we talking about? There's no technology. Technology is a commodity today. Even the largest of the companies, innovation is an acquisition. How many big companies can you think of which have actually innovated something, a billion-dollar product, out of their own lab? Even Facebook didn't get it right. Facebook ended up being a one-trick pony. Facebook had no idea about mobile strategy, so they ultimately had to go and acquire companies like Instagram and WhatsApp just to get their mobile strategy right. So it's not that everybody is going to be able to get it all right, right? These are what we call as the one-trick ponies. And because a lot of talent base is really more tech-focused, whereas a lot of products are today getting out of the data centers and research labs and really getting to people like you and I and my uncle and my grandmother who have no clue about technology nor they want to do anything, you have to think of user experience. I mean, if I take all your cell phones and put it on this table, 99% of them will look exactly alike. In form factor, in buttons, and even if I go inside and look at functionality. And even if I start making a price point kind of a comparison, I will find that most of them will I can make buckets, but then most of them. So how do you decide? Technology is the same, price points are similar. Why do you decide the product that you buy? Tell me. In my view, it is the only thing left to differentiate in this world now: user experience. And when I say user experience, 99% of the people think of UI. UI is only one of the components of user experience. UI is not user experience. To me, user experience is about how do I discover information about your product? How do I really think about trialing it out, right? So we talked about the try, buy before you try kind of a thing. How do I do that? How do I buy it? How do I get after sales? The whole nine yards of that. So everything has a big role to play in terms of design here. The specs were very, very monolithic. I mean, I remember 95, we were making network management software for Siemens ATM switches, right? And the MRD that we got had a five-year roadmap. Now, that was my first job out of defense. Defense was government, which was, I mean, the only people who used to do a five-year planning was Soviet Union, right? And the next best was government of India. Thankfully, both Soviet Union is dead, and government of India has decided to change it, right? Because nobody else is really, any of you do a five-year planning for your personal life or something? Right? It's too difficult, too scary, right? So the point is, when you have such a long-drawn kind of a thing and a forecast-driven thing, today it's more like a very opportunistic kind of a thing. Chances are, so I have a question to all of you. How many of you, if somebody, you or somebody on your team actually comes up with an idea, how soon can you put it in the hands of customer? Raise your hand if you can do it in less than 6 months. 6 months, guys. Okay, I see a lot of hands which are like trying to go up, but they are not really up there. How many of you in your teams can actually claim or try it out that if you have an idea, you can put it in the hands of customers as a working software in less than 6 months? Doesn't matter, forget about the idea. How soon can you get a validation on the idea? How soon can you test the key assumptions about that? Below 6 months. I see less than 10% hand going up. Do yourself a favor. Go to a site known as gv.com. GV is Google Ventures. In Google Ventures, they do a lot of mentoring to the startups. They actually teach them tools about how do you prototype and put the ideas in the hand of customers as a working software. Simple tools. Can you imagine how much time do they give for that? 20 minutes. They teach people how to put idea in the hands of people in 20 minutes flat. And I don't care what is your idea, as long as it's a digital idea, you should be able to show. I don't want to show you 5 pages of minutes of meeting or a Microsoft Word document. I want to show you a working software. Can you show me a working software in half an hour? Each one of you is capable of doing it. Why are you taking 6 months for that? We are living in a different world here, right? So these are the things. And I think there was a question about techies growing into PMs. I mean, 20 years back when I joined industry, Siemens, Philips, Huawei, all these were all heavy tech companies. We were doing machine assembly language programming. We were designing routers. We were doing physical, electrical, mechanical, electronics design. In defense, when I was there, we were doing all that kind of stuff. I never saw any professional MBA being hired there. But today, I see an increasing number of professional MBA being hired. And the main reason is that the focus was really more of tech, but the focus of a lot of products today is more consumer facing. You need to understand, how many of you even heard of terms like ethnography or anthropology or user design, user behavior? A lot of these products really rely on them. When I used to work at Yahoo, for example, I'll just give a short example of how analytics and user behavior and all this come together. In 2008, when Obama joined the presidential campaign, he was not the leader, he was not the first choice, because as a black man, never has happened in US, so he was not the most natural choice, he was not people's hero. He was lagging by double digit when he joined the campaign. So his team came up with a way to say, we'll create a digital campaign here to engage with the voters. And they said, we'll have a media clipping and we'll have a button there. And what could go wrong with a media clipping and a button, right? But then somebody said, hey, why don't we look at do we have other combinations? They said, we have 6 media clippings and 4 buttons. And they said, how do we know if this is the best one? Maybe there is other combination. So what they did was 6 × 4 is 24 combinations. For 2 weeks, they ran a series of tests. So these 24 combinations were served to about 3 lakh people who came to that website in the next 2 weeks. So roughly about every combination got about 13,000 people. And what they found to their surprise was the combination they had chosen was not the most engaging one. When I say engaging, how do you know it's an engaging one? How many people actually click on the button and pledge the money, right? So they were all pledging about $21 on an average, and the conversion in the original one was only 8.26%, And the conversion in combination 11 that they came up with, the combination 11 was one of the, so some of them had Obama with the dog, some of them Obama with his wife, some of them had Obama with the family, going out for a walk or something. And the button said, tell me more, or I am in, or something there. Now, many of you techies must be saying, a button is a button is a button. How does it even matter, right? I mean, I can write anything on the damn button, and that should not make a difference. But wait till I tell you to this, the whole story. Combination 11 turned out that instead of the original combination of 8.26% of conversions, it created 11% conversions. Now, again, some of you must be wondering, these numbers are so small. Why is this guy acting so funny about these numbers? Anyone from online space here, like a Google or a Yahoo or somebody deals with advertising or CTRs and all? You know how many people on an average people click on the click-through rate, the CTR that we track in a company like Yahoo? Like 1%. Majority of the emails don't get opened. They straight away get deleted. Majority of the times people, I mean, this generation of users is awesome. We have trained ourselves so much that we have become a human ad blocker. Like, we ignore everything, and we straight away go to the content and don't even click on something, right? So if 8.2% people were clicking at that became 11, that was a 40% uptick in that. And that number, when they did all the math there, they were originally saying that we'll have about 7.2 million pledging $21 for Obama's campaign. That number went to 10 million people. So an additional 2.8 million people pledged $21 each. $60 million was the additional amount that Obama and his team got there. In addition to the fact that it was not just about money, they got 2.2 million more people who could connect with the message. A lot of people say actually that one of the key reasons was this kind of a strategy where they were able to align very well with them. Now, if you are a product manager, forget about knowing your Hadoop, Hive, Pig, and all that stuff there. It's all a given. Today, if you are in the business of machine learning, go to AWS. Machine learning is available out of the box. Anyone wants to do facial recognition in their program? Go to a website known as algorithmia.com. Has anyone tried algorithmia.com? Go there. They on the landing page itself, you will see in 5 lines of code, you can build a pattern recognition capability for your program. You don't need a PhD computer science in your on your team increasingly. Yeah, some people will still need, but 95% people, if they want to build a machine learning out of the box, on an AWS they can get. If they want to create, the other day I saw one of the mailbox, somebody said, how to write a chatbot without writing a single line of code. We have already come to that extent where there are frameworks available that you can create your own chatbot without a single line of a code. So what kind of a technology stack are we talking about here? What you need is, like, go back and do yourself a favor. Talk to some of the architects whom you know. How many of them know how to make a brick? They don't need to. That's the question. They are talking about increasingly an interdisciplinary thinking of how do you really take ideas and really build a product there for the kind of market that we are into. I mean, think of Uber. Is there any world-class idea about technology stack of Uber that you can think of? It's basically using the APIs, the geo APIs that Google is giving. It's creating a great user interface. Again, no earth-shattering technology on that. But the unique combination of that allows you the whole aggregation platform and the ease of use and the payment gateway options creates Uber as a $67 billion valuation company. But if you think of it, is there something that you could not have thought of by yourself? I mean, I doubt that. So the kind of products that we are building is changing in a great way. It doesn't mean everywhere, but there is an increasing number of consumerization of IT that is happening there. And I think this is something we need to understand there. So with that kind of a thing, let's just go and kind of look at what is a product manager and what does it really need for a product manager to succeed, right? In my view, a PM is really the number one customer champion. If I've only been given two words to express, I will say customer champion. A PM is really, I see it as a continuum. On one hand, I have a big technology, and the other hand, I have a big user focus. If it's a very heavy technology kind of a product there, I'll need to have a lot of technologists there. Arun talked about some of the things from a Microsoft point of view where the PMs had to have a lot of technology perspective there, right? When I worked with companies like Yahoo and I see a lot of consumer-facing companies, I see a lot of people talking about, 2 days back I was at the Grace Hopper conference, I was a panelist on the human computing. I had one of the Microsoft researchers, she was an ethnographer. And these are the people who are actually doing a deep study of the human behavior to design and develop the products. They don't care about the technology stack as much as they really care about the user experiences. Because there are people There are products in that category, right? So I think that's an important thing. And what do the PMs do? I think the biggest thing PMs doing is knowing what to build without knowing what to build. Does it make sense? Think about it. If you already know what to build, chances are you are a totally lousy product manager. Because you are copying something that is already known to mankind and all you are doing is just rehashing that. Where is the question of radically changing and putting a dent in the universe that Steve Jobs used to talk so passionately about? The point is you have to build something, but you don't really know what am I building here. I mean, I have some high-level vision of what I really want to do, but I have no clue how am I going to get to that point. A truly remarkable world-class product manager, in my view, has to have feet in the ground but head in the clouds. Has to really be able to oscillate between abstract and if it is too abstract, obviously it will never happen, it will never ship. But if it is too concrete, chances are very... Have you heard of a guy of name Reid Hoffman? Who is Reid Hoffman? He is the co-founder of LinkedIn. One of the great quotes by him is, if you are not embarrassed by the first version of your product, you have released it too late. You should be embarrassed. You should almost be apologetic about it. You should run away from your neighbors when they see you. Your product should be so lousy. Right? Because if it is already known to people and if it's already a very shiny product there, you have released it too late. You cannot get any validation. You probably are already looking for a confirmation bias rather than a validation here. Right? So that kind of a thing. So what are some of the things that I have found which actually can help? And what do the PMs don't do? This is the interesting part. PMs don't sell, PMs don't design, they don't write code, they don't launch products. Yeah, in some companies, they might be launching the more market-facing PMs, but by and large, they don't create marketing campaigns, they don't support customers, they don't fix bugs, they don't do site-ups. But knowing and doing it doesn't hurt, right? You still have to basically work with a team that is doing all that stuff on your behalf, but the thing is, you don't know how to do it. So I think a PM cannot be a person who can be sitting in the cubicle in a corner and think the whole world is going to come to their doors. The PM should be a person who is able to create not only a physical space, but a mental space where all these things can confluence and they are able to, and it can work together. So some of the things that I want to share here of what you can do to reach the top. What are the things that I have seen myself in my experiences or what I've learned from gurus or some of them are the things there. So let me get first thing. The first thing to me is develop your passion. I think some of the speakers in the previous session talked about that. So I think the passion is an important part of it. Just doing your job is not going to get the job done, right? You need to fall in love with your job. There has to be a sense of a deeper passion, and that's why I was asking you to think of what is that deeper passion that you care for. Because if it is only for a paycheck, there are 1,000 ways that you can make money. It's not about money. It's not about a steady paycheck. It's about what you truly believe in, right? Somebody might believe in and say, for example, we had Naidu here who talked about Mera events. And it's like that's the belief that he had that I think we need to have this kind of a product, and he built that product there. Or if Anu is working on Map My Genome, that's the kind of belief that she has there. 13 years, and they still are going strong with that. In 13 years, they would have lived and died 1,000 times. I can tell you, I am living that entrepreneurial journey for the last 2 years. An entrepreneur goes through extreme bouts of hope and extreme desperation 10 times a day. So if you, and when I say entrepreneur, don't get fixed up on this mental model of two people sitting in a garage and drinking a lot of beer. An entrepreneur is as much a person inside a 20,000 people company who is basically trying to solve an unknown problem. So it is not about a physical space, it's about a mental space of solving a complex problem which never has been solved before. We just call them intrapreneur, but it's the same thing in that. In some sense, it could be more difficult because an entrepreneur by definition is going to fail hundreds of times. Have you heard of a guy of name James Dyson? Some of you have heard of them? The Dyson's guy? Right, the Dyson's vacuum cleaner. So James Dyson was a vacuum cleaner salesman. He was not a techie. But because he was selling salesman, actually he was not really selling. Most of the people were rejecting the vacuum cleaner. So he said, hey, I think the world needs a better vacuum cleaner. And for the next 5.5 years, he committed to put his own money, effort, and time in building the world's best vacuum cleaner. You know how many times he failed? Any guess? Sorry? 4,000 times? He actually failed 5,126 times. In 5,127th time, James Dyson built the world's best vacuum cleaner. It was so good that retailers in UK were shit scared of that. They said, we'll not sell it in UK. So he went to Japan and started selling them in Japan. They sell for 1,200 pounds. That's like 1.25 lakh. Of course, Dyson's has continued to be a powerhouse of innovation. Some of you might have seen the pictures of the bladeless fans they have built. They recently came up with a bladeless hair dryer as well, right? So amazing kind of a culture, amazing kind of a mindset. But imagine for 5 years, if every day you are failing 10 times a day, like James Dyson, 5,126 times, are you doing it for money? If you don't have a passion, you will give up. You should give up. No point in killing yourself this way. I mean, if you don't have a passion, don't get into the race to build the most awesome product the world needs to get. Because it's not about money, it's not about a gratification, it's not about making your neighbors happy. It's about simple fact of what you truly believe in. If you don't have that passion, you'll be history. You'll be history either ways, right? If you build something, you'll be history. If you don't build, you'll anyway be history. The second thing is, a lot of us are growing into siloed mindset. What is the craziest thing you guys have done other than completing your education and joining a job? Anyone has gone for a marathon here? Great. So that's wonderful. Anything else? Anyone else has done anything crazy? Totally, totally unrelated to what you are paid for.
5,900 meters, 53
kilometers in balance. Great. Awesome. Amazing. Here, one thing I have done and I can talk about is in 93, I became crazy. I raised my hand and I said, I want to go to Antarctica. And I went and lived in Antarctica for 16 months. And I think most of my learning is because of my 16 months of stay. Because have you seen Big Boss? We were like in a Big Boss kind of a house. The only thing is, we had no clue what was, this was like long back, 93. But it allowed me to talk and learn about things which had nothing to do with my subject, which was computer science. I learned about nature. Most importantly, I learned about the human nature. What happens? How do we behave the way we behave? We can master technology. We are all smart people. We can figure it out. But the most difficult thing to understand is human nature. In fact, actually, it's the other way around. The human nature is the easiest, but we refuse to understand that. That's the way, right? Human beings, in my view, are the most logical people. It's just that there's a different logic to human people, right? But coming to the Medici effect, there is this whole notion of T-shaped individual. Has anyone heard of that? So now there's many words for that. In Scrum, we call it as generalizing specialist. Some companies call them as polyglots. Some people call them as polyskilling. But the key thing is, like the letter T of the alphabet, you take one letter, one core skill, which might be your front end or programming or Java or testing or design or Selenium, what have you. But then over a period of time, you're kind of broadening your spectrum so that you are able to assimilate all these subjects together. And at a certain fundamental level, I think a product leadership to me is really all about, I'll talk about Medici effect in a moment, but to me a PM itself is actually a T-shaped individual. And you need to obviously have core PM skills to understand that, but then along with that you need to understand things like market research, user experience, engineering, business analysis, and then things like finance and pricing. How do you price the product, right? Tech, for example, competition, and so on and so forth there. So unless you really understand them, you cannot really just say that my core PM skills are going to make. So some people are asking questions on training, so education, certification, and all. They'll get you put a foot in the door. They'll allow you to get an entry inside. But to really succeed in the job, you need to really do all that stuff there. Now, one of the ways, obviously, I'm talking at an IPL event. Rahul hasn't paid me to say that. But one thing I can tell you is, because I'm a faculty at IPL for the last few years now, we actually help people understand and really build a more holistic mindset. And in a way, this is like what we call as the Medici effect. Anyone is aware of what is Medici? Or has anyone heard of this book, Medici Effect? Thank you, sir. During the Renaissance period, this was the richest family in Europe, actually. They were bankers. And Medici's actually were raised out of Florence in Italy. And they were the people who basically bankrolled everything. So they got, and their method was very unique. What they did was they actually created these paloozas where all these people basically came there, and they were Leonardo da Vinci's of the world, and they were Galileos of the world, and they were artists and poets and philosophers and doctors, and they all came together and lived under the same roof. And there was nothing told that we expect anything from you. There was no expectation from them whatsoever. The idea was to let them just chat up and just work with each other. Now, if your people living together, they are breaking bread three times a day, they are chatting up, there will be some interesting kind of things happen. So this author, Franz Johansson, has written this wonderful book which he calls as the Medici Effect. And Medici Effect is essentially all about developing the mindset where instead of a physical space, you actually create a Medici effect in your mind. The thing is, if you are only if you say I am a Java guy and all I do is and hang around with people who speak Java, you are already dead. Accept it from me. Because 90% of the times I see when I do mentoring of startups, I see a bunch of techies get together because they are expert programmers. They make up some cool program, and then they come and say, I have developed a solution, now I'm searching for a problem. That's the most common failure pattern that I see in the startup industry. It's a solution in search of a problem. Because they cannot think, they have a limitation. They are not able to think because they have never seen the world outside it. The most prolific inventors, James Dyson could not have invented, or a technical engineer instead of James Dyson could never have probably made the world's best vacuum cleaner. The only reason James Dyson was able to do because he had the insight of knowing what the people care for, knowing what the people want, understanding their needs, and then walking backwards from there. Not walking from technology to the solution, but walking from the needs towards the solution. Technology is an incidental part of it. Let's understand, I'm a technologist, right? But it doesn't mean that I will just throw my technology at people. How many people, what percentage of people do you think are still using Windows XP in the world today? A few years back when I checked, the number used to be about 65% people. A product that has had end of sale, the product that has had end of life, all kind of things have happened, no sales is available, but people are still using it. That is human nature. I mean, I think Sumit talked about some of the B2B. B2B kind of a thing is even more brutal. B2C is a different kind of a thing. B2B is like, you have products that have a very long shelf life. They go on forever, right? So you need to understand a lot of these things before you can really start building compelling products, because there's no single moving part there. Okay, let's keep moving. A lot of times we are looking for great, very glamorous, very sexy opportunities and say, okay, I think there should be somewhere. I want really to change the world. I want to really work on a product that has $1 billion revenue. Forget about it. The most important work people do is not find opportunities, but solve the messy problems. If you can solve the messiest of the problems, that's where the gold is. Don't go looking for somewhere gold. Look for the problems. Look for things which has the maximum source of, let us say, customer turnover. Look at sources, for example, which has the maximum amount of employee turnover. Or like in Blue Ocean Strategy, some of you might have heard of, we don't talk about customers so much, we talk about non-customers. For example, you might be focusing on customers, but guess what? Every product, probably 90% of the world is non-customer for them. Think about it. If you are able to find a way to sell it to them and solve their problems, it might be something phenomenal for them. So try to find and look for the problems. Don't look for opportunities. In real world, we say opportunities typically have a label written on their forehead which reads as problems. Behind the label problem, there is an opportunity lying there, right? So go ahead and solve that problem first. Another thing that we do is, a lot of times, at the more junior I am, and most of I think that's where the kind of leadership pretty much decides, is like, we don't take initiative, right? Like this cartoon says, hey, when are you going to show some initiative, Finlay? When you tell me to, sir. Whenever you tell me to take initiative, I will do that, sir. Like, come on. There's an excellent article on, and I'm sure, how many of you had your appraisal recently? Most of you are going through? 90% of the appraisal, probably globally, there is one thing that your manager is always going to tell you: take more initiative. Would you agree with that? And the fun part is, neither your manager knows how to measure it, nor you know how to measure it. But everyone wants more initiative, right? On my blog, okay, soft plug on my for my blog, I wrote a blog post a few years back based on some technique that I learned about 20 years back on how do you measure. So there's a 5-point scale on measuring initiative. Those interested can just search for it. How to measure initiative, I think they will land on my blog. But the point I'm saying is, in general, taking initiative is, I have seen, the only way future leaders are made. Despite all the, I mean, I think this was an observation by Peter Drucker or somebody, some management guru, or somebody at that stature. It's like, despite all the leadership programs, I have not seen a single leader who came out of the leadership MBAs or programs. The leaders are still coming out of people like Jack Ma, or people like Alessandro, what's the name of Zara's co-founder? The world's second richest man, right? These are the people who have never gone to school. These are not the people who are any exceptional. They just had a knack for taking initiative, solving the problems, and learning things fast. That's all it is, right? Think, a lot of times we have been told, think conservative, think, okay, we are doing it. But I think creativity is, to me, the most important thing in today's world. We are talking about a world which has gradually is wrong word, probably it has steadily and now increasingly moving from compliance to creativity, from execution to exploration. This is a world where the best ideas are not about how best can you execute it. Because the best execution has already been done, and execution is not going to get you any more dollars. I mean, think of the most value creating products or name in the last 5 years that you have heard of. Are they a result because there was a great Six Sigma program at work? Or a great CMMI or a great PMP program at work? By the way, I have certification in all of them, so I'm qualified to speak on that. The point is, the best of the ideas which are becoming... So, for example, a Snapchat. Any of you is in a Snapchat? Good, I would be worried because those people would be teenagers actually, right? Have you heard of the joke? If you have a Hotmail mail ID, that means you are in the age group of 45 to 55. If you have a Yahoo mail ID, then you are in 35 to 45. If you have a Gmail, you are in like 25 to 35. And if you have no mail ID, you are probably the Facebook, WhatsApp generation, right? Very interesting observation. So Snapchat, what does Snapchat do? All it does is allow you to take pictures that will destroy itself. I mean, how many of in this room would actually want to build a product like that? They have just filed for an IPO. They are looking at a $20 billion company. That's the business model we are talking about, right? So things are changing, and creativity is an important part of it, right? So I think a lot of new business models are available to you to try it out if only you are willing to step out of the box and think more creatively. That's the key point here. Okay, let's keep going. How many of people here blog? 3, 4, 5... Okay, thanks, you guys are brave, courageous people. I hope if there's one thing I can teach you is just write something. I've been blogging for 12 years. Every time what goes in your mind when you put a blog out? What's your mental state when you write a blog and release it? Okay, and after you release, what happens to you? I mean, what is going on in your mind? You start feeling good, that's...
Yeah.
Wonderful, wonderful. Even after 12 years, and I've been a published author, I wrote a book for apress.com last year, it released. Whenever I write a blog there, my heart is pounding 200 times. Because the internet is waiting to beat you down with their opinion, right? And let's be honest, the life is not worth living complying with the rules of others, right? The life is only what you make of yourself. So if a blog post is only going to be a reflection of what others think, and you are writing to make others happy, you may not as well write something. That's the point, right? So the reason why I'm saying is that when you write something, it is the first step you are taking for creation. Now, there can be n number of ways of creating something, right? You can make a video blog, right? You can start like the Khan Academy, you can start, and you can, all you need is a studio, and you can become a Salman Khan like that, right? Not that Salman Khan, but the Salman Khan of Khan Academy. Or you can be a great blogger and create your own something. Who knows, you will create a Huffington Post out of it, right? The point is, if you have any idea in your head and you do not find a channel or a way to communicate with the people, you are as well not having that idea. How many of you people have been trained, formally trained, that you can read others' mind? Can you read others' mind? I mean, the last time I checked, I don't think most of us know how to read others' mind. So what is going on in your mind if you have a great idea? How do I know? How do I care? If you do not find a way to articulate your ideas, express it in some way, either in verbal or in writing or in video, or the best thing is if you can build some prototype around it and show me, it is useless. There is some, it's not a scientific study, but I think this came in one of the Scientific American issues, that we get roughly about 30,000 to 50,000 ideas every day. And I think going by your own admission of how many of us really take the first step of really sharing it and putting it out in front of people, I can safely say that almost 100% of them die an unnatural death every day. Right? Is it safe to say that? And yet we say, I want to change the world. Yeah, so you can have your own ways of doing. Some people want to have you keep your dictaphone. Do something. The point is, your idea is useless. Believe me, we make the whole idea thing very sexy. The world doesn't care about your opinion. The world changes by your example, not by your opinion. I think somebody said that. The point is, if you do not convert that into something tangible, it is useless. So do something. Writing is only, to me, a placeholder of it. Writing is, as Zinser said, writing is thinking on paper. All you are doing is you are thinking on paper. That's about it. But if you can go to the advanced form of thinking, where you can actually build something out of it, go ahead and do that. So it says that, yeah, just share that, right? Maybe they have that lever there, right? Facebook also says done is better than perfect. They used to have a credo for a long period of time, done is better than perfect. The idea is a lot of us don't write or share our ideas because we think people will make fun of me. They will ridicule me. They will reject me. And I don't want to be rejected by the system, so I'm just going to keep shut. By not sharing the idea, you're not helping anyone. You're certainly not helping you. That's who should be the biggest, beneficiary of that, right? A lot of times we are really thinking, I want to be an expert, I want to be a critic, I want to do this. I think the simplest thing is just be a maker. To me, maker is this biggest thing. Maker is the whole, there's a new movement of maker manifesto or maker. The whole idea is, whatever you choose, don't just be a PowerPoint guy. I am enough here to be a PowerPoint guy, right? The point is, PowerPoint is the most useless thing ever created. It gives a false illusion of competency when you don't really have the competency. Your competency is not about presenting something, unless you want to be a public speaker and present it. Like I present 30 times a year. I do that, so that's the chosen field that I have. But if you believe that you are a techie or you really have some core skill, be a maker. Build something. Start building something there which allows people to benefit from there so that you can show your ideas in real action there. That is the most valuable thing that you will ever do to yourself. I was talking to some people over the lunch and we were talking, like, how best do I demonstrate my capability as a product manager or do something? I said, the best thing I know is there is only one way of really doing something, and which is volunteer. Just volunteer for something. I've been a volunteer for the last 20 years. Anyone here volunteers for professional, personal, social, cultural, anything? Raise your hand. A great shout out to all of you guys. You guys are awesome. Do something where there is nobody is asking or expecting you to do. I am sure a lot of people who raise their hands, there must be times when they are getting up at 4 in the morning because they have committed their time for going at some place for volunteering for a cause, even if they are running a 102 fever. Would some of you be able to relate to that? That is volunteering for me. It's not about money, it's not about prestige, it's not about ego. Your team leader might be somebody half your age, so it's not about hierarchy as well. It's about what you truly believe in. Yes. So do that and be a maker and really build something there, right? I mean, show something that your ideas can actually take the shape and form of it. And again, and by that, I'm also asking us, see, there is this whole notion, skills is a very powerful word in English vocabulary. Skills definitely is not about what we know or the certificates that I put on the wall. Skills at a very fundamental is all about what we do with the hands and the fingers. That is the whole notion of skills. So if you don't really do something, play around, tinker around with your hands and fingers, please don't put it as a skill on your LinkedIn profile. Put it as I sat in the class and I warmed the seat for 2 hours. That would suffice. Skill is a thing where you actually demonstrate the capability. right? And that's a very different part than sitting in the classroom and getting a certification here. Right? So be a maker. Don't learn by just doing or experimenting. Learn by shipping. And that's what I also wanted to say when I talked about blogging. Unless you are shipping your ideas in any shape or form, whether it is text, whether it is blog, if you are great in presentation skills, just go ahead and put up a video blog there. And don't care about those three people who laugh at you. Every one of us has gone through the cycle where more than three people have laughed at us. Imagine, how many of you have been a child before? We all were child once upon a time. Do we agree with that? And what was the age when we were 8 months old and we were just walking and crawling? We were not even walking. We were crawling on our knees. And one day we started, somebody gave us a support and we just took the first step and we kind of started to lift ourselves up. And what happened to us at that point in time? We invariably fell down. And after that we kept standing up and we kept falling down thousands of times till we got it right. What if on the seventh or second or fifth attempt, I made up my mind, hey, there are too many people rejecting or ridiculing me. I think I don't want to get up next time. What do you think would happen to the humankind? I think the humankind would stop evolving right then and there if every child decides that I'm not going to walk up because there are too many people watching me or they are laughing at me. And it's like, hey, what will those people say? And then we don't want to take. And it's like in fact, since I've been a leader and I've had VP roles, I think the biggest impediment today to leadership is, oh, if I really go and sign up for a Coursera class and somebody comes to know an engineer, oh, that guy is a VP, he's learning. It's like that guy doesn't know what is Python. I mean, come on. Our industry thrives on learning. If you are not going to learn, you are dead. Please step away from this industry, right? The point is, if you want to be in the industry, this is the joy of being in software industry, that you continue to learn there. And if you don't learn it, you're not going to do that. And don't keep learning to just doing something, but even ship something. 5 more minutes? Time is up, okay, I'm just a few more slides. Sorry. I think failure is something that, again, our society has kind of stigmatized failure for a long period of time. A lot of culturization, socialization in our society is meant so that we stop people from doing something crazy, right? Because we think craziness is not safe, and if it is not safe, then you should not be doing it. But I think the most important thing that you can really do yourself is keep failing all the time. Don't worry about being embarrassed. You're not doing anything wrong, unethical, immoral, illegal. Failing is okay. I mean, failing is not as in like you get up in the morning and say, okay, I'm going to fail today. It's not about that, right? So please understand, it's not about that you like do that kind of a thing. But failing is like, I mean, it's that same child example, right? If you are not willing to accept and embrace failures, there cannot be any learning. Somebody was asking about the education. I always differentiate between education and learning, and I don't allow them to mix up with each other. Education is what you get when you sit in the classroom or you read something. Learning is what you do with what you are educated with. There is a big difference in that. A lot of people confuse education and learning and they say, I have learned this subject. You have probably only been educated in that. You have never learned something unless you have really tried it out more than a couple of times, ideally failed in that process and so on and so forth, right? So please understand that it is like the fail fast, fail cheap, fall forward mantra which is there in the whole lean startup and entrepreneurial space. James Dyson to me is the gold standard of failing and succeeding. Remember, I have spoken that so many times, I remember 5,126 times. I wish to at least say that message that many times. Forget about being able to probably do that, right? Okay, be a scribe, be a newscaster, be a storyteller. If you cannot articulate your ideas, if you cannot tell it, again, you might have some great ideas. Who cares? Welcome to Nobody Cares. Population is 6 billion people. How many people care about your story? How many people care about your ideas? Probably more than 6 billion people. If you don't have the same passion, if you cannot hold I'll give myself a little bit of credit. At the end of a long day, if I cannot hold your attention on a Saturday afternoon when you are raring to go back to your homes and your personal lives, I don't think I am a good storyteller. If I cannot bring and infuse the same level of enthusiasm and passion in you, then all that thing is useless, right? And we have great opportunity to do that every single time, whether at work, whether at play, whether at society. So I think be a storyteller and see really how you can build the same thing. Work hard. I think this has been a confusion in our industry. Every 5 years, we confuse between work hard, and then it goes to smart, then it goes to again hard, then it goes to smart. I have settled myself. I think end of the day, it is working really hard. It's not about, to me, it's not about smart. Smart was considered as sexy, right? Oh, I'm a smart worker, right? I'm a cool dude, like that kind of thing. Come on, guys. If you want to change the world, straight and simple, if you are not willing to put 100 hours a week, you cannot change the world. If you want to achieve extraordinary, you have to put that extra before the ordinary. There is a reason we call it extraordinary. And the reason is that there is a lot of extra before the ordinary. If you want to achieve extraordinary with ordinary efforts, good luck. Right? You have to think about that. So I think in my view, I don't think you can change the world by the normal way of thinking. Influence without authority is an important part as a product leader, because you are going to influence people who don't report to you. You cannot make them happy. You cannot give them promotion. You cannot give them bonus. You cannot fire them. You cannot do anything. You still have to get the job done. Influence without authority is a subject. In fact, I teach that at the IPL. Right now I'm teaching that, which is like a one credit course itself. So we spend like 12 hours talking about this. It's a big subject by itself. But the key thing is, it should influence if it means anything. Yes. We talked about passion in the earlier slide. So this is now like, what do you do with the passion? You're solving the problem. Make sure you are willing to do. So work hard. Have you heard of the 10,000 hour? Become a programmer and created basic interpreter at the age of 21 by just getting up one day and saying, I'm going to do that. It's hard. How do you do that? So that could be your point of view, and I respect it, right? The point is, this is something which I have seen. Well, that's okay. So again, the point I am saying is, I haven't seen anyone. There are people who can get lucky. They can get by a little bit of a luck and a lot of other things, and maybe some smart people. I think a lot of us are not that smart, and we will have to really put in midnight hours to get to that point. That's all I am saying. Right? Now you choose your pick. If you believe you can actually optimize and make it smarter, then that's fine. That's perfectly okay. Anybody. That guy, Manji, whose wife died because there was a mountain in front of him, what did he decide to do? The mountain man.
He broke the mountain.
How much time did he do? 30 years. That became his life's mission. The point is, I totally agree with you, none of us have to be Steve Jobs. But we all can be a Steve Jobs in whatever we rightfully believe is ours. But that cannot happen in one weekend. So my point is, that persistence is what I call as the hard work. And unless you are willing to put in the hard work, and you say, okay, I will send 5 emails and the job will be done, sorry. The work doesn't work on your emails. Right? That's the point. So you'll have to put a lot of hard work there. Right? Influence without authority. Trust the team. I think you are going to work a lot with the team. Software development, product development is a team sport. You cannot win if the team is not all firing on all the cylinders at the same time, right? So be willing to do that, and you'll have to trust a lot of team decisions. If you have to win all the time, then you might have to work alone. So be ready for that. You have to. It's a give and take, in my view, right? Enjoy the ride. It's an important thing. There will be ups and downs. No product is going to sail in the straight line. I think Sumit gave a great perspective on there is nothing like a straight line, it's all circles. No product is going to go. Most of the great companies, if you read their story, they were like, we were 2 weeks away from bankruptcy, and then suddenly this whole thing happened. And then we became a billion-dollar company. This happens. This is not the stuff the fairy tales are made of. This is the real type stuff, right? So don't try to be too systematic and predict that, no, I have to have this kind of a thing, and this is the only way my success will be measured. In reality, you will have to prepare to go down, and you'll have to come up again and again go down, and 10 times a day, like I said, eventually you will hit upon what is the right way. So enjoy that ride. Let me just recap here. I think I've taken more time, but let me just quickly recap. I think product manager to me is an orchestration role. It is not a hierarchy. It is an orchestration role. You need to be a leader, not a boss, because you are going to really work with a lot of peers. These are the people who have egos in their own right and in their own standing in profession. like you have your own ego. The most successful people will not be the best techie guys who will always understand the technology, but they will also be able to kind of find the way to work with the people and kind of align them with what their aspirations and priorities are. While expertise of various functions is not really required, knowledge of them would be handy. It again depends. One of the products I remember, we were working in embedded software in Philips. First one, I was doing healthcare in Philips. Our product manager was a nurse, and he had been a nurse in Netherlands because male nurses are common in outside India. He was a nurse at a hospital for 30 years. And he came and became a product manager because he was the best person. He knew exactly what the departments, the hospital wanted. The second product I was working at Philips was a very complex digital video, like the set-top box that you use, Tata Sky kind of a thing. We were building in 98. We were the first team in India who was working on that. Nobody knew. Nobody had seen a set-top box. My product manager was a PhD in computer science. And he had to be a person like that because we were doing a lot of those code-level compression algorithms and codecs and a lot of stuff that was going on there. So one had to take those kind of decisions. Even though there was a lot of user-facing, the core technology uncertainty was really in the tech stack rather than in the uncertainty. So you'll have to really kind of do that. To me, the top for a product leader is really making the dent in the universe, whatever universe you choose to make, whatever dent you want to make there. And no dent is small, no universe is small. It's really what you really believe that you want to focus in, right? You surely need to know the PM skills. And of course, IPL will help. And like I said, this is not a paid endorsement. Someone like IPL will, and there could be n number of other mechanisms. But invest in building your core PM skills. That's an important thing. If you don't know, somebody says, what is your SAM, TAM, and SOM? And you are like, hey, what is SAM, TAM, and SOM? And you are going to Google in front of your manager. That may not be the best idea. So you need to know the core PM skills, and you need to understand things like market segmentation and pricing and so on and so forth. No substitute for that. Learn it by yourself, Coursera or IPL, that's your call. So that I think you need to do. More importantly, to me, it's a product mindset, which is a must. End of the day, it's about the most passionate people. They, I want to build something. I want to understand how people are using, what kind of pain points do they have, what are the challenges do we face, and so on and so forth. So I think that, to me, is really the whole pinnacle of that. With that, I think I have kind of run out of all the time there. This will be on slide share, so have a look at it. I'll tweet about that in a few hours, so you can see that thing. And I think you will be able to kind of have a look at it. With that, I think I've run out of time totally, but I don't know how much time do I have for any questions there.
You need to run for your flight.
I need to run for my flight,
that
more important
than that. That is the only
reason
I am not entertaining anything, but okay. I couldn't stop you.
Okay.
That was such a captivating presentation.
Thanks a lot.
So, thank you so much.
I'll stop here, I think.